There's been quite a lot of speculation on astro forums in the UK recently about the much anticipated EQ7 equatorial mount from Skywatcher. We've got a little bit more information that we can share with you about it, and in particular we've actually got an EQ7 mount here to show you. It's on permanent display at the showroom here at the Astronomy and Nature Centre, so if you live within travelling distance you can just drop over and actually have a look at it for yourself. But if you can't make the travelling, I'm going to give you a quick video tour of the EQ7 to sort of bring you up to speed about the main salient points about the mount. We can't answer any questions at the moment about the availability of the mount, and to be honest, we don't know much more than the rumour that's flying around on forums. We've looked at this and think it's probably a pre-production model rather than a prototype. But the importer is not giving away any information about when the mount will actually be available. Some people are calling it the EQ7 or EQ8. We're not even sure about that. So we can't be drawn on those issues because we just don't know the answer to it. So I'm just going to confine myself to the technical features of the mount and give you a little bit more insight into that. I think you probably get a better view, Drew, if you actually come around the side here so that I can show you some of the features on the mount. The running gear is familiar. From the EQ6 and EQ5 Pro models. You're going to be very familiar with that if you've got either of those telescopes, and that makes it fairly easy and approachable. But there are some fairly significant differences when it's compared with the EQ6. Not least is the carrying capacity at around about 45 kilos. We don't know any more information about the relationship of that and the counterbalance weights, but at the moment we're told that the carrying capacity is expected to be 45 kilos. You'll note that the motor blocks are actually external to the casings of the telescope, which is certainly a departure from the EQ6. Function is largely the same. We've got these screw-on cable connectors here. Also, the defining resolution of these stepper motors is considerably better than the resolution of the EQ6. On the EQ6, we've got 1.8 of a degree resolution for the stepper motor steps. We're expecting 0.9 of a degree with the EQ7/EQ8. The mount design is really quite substantial. We've got this kind of box structure on the tripod head. It's quite heavily reinforced with webs and is doweled and pinned onto the slipping base here for to get the azimuth positioning. The adjustment is fairly standard with the push me, pull you screws. On the base here, quite easy. One departure from anything we've seen on the EQ6, EQ5, instead of that rather simple M10 bolt at the rear, we've got this really very substantial altitude tilt mechanism. And the position of that can actually be varied. So depending on the local latitude, you can see this plate has been designed so that it can be put at different positions on the mount here, so that the angle of the bolt here addresses the thrust face on the rear of the altitude action position is squarer. This tends to mean that this bolt will actually be easier to operate, so it isn't going to be at very acute angles in its contact with this plate that you can see. It's actually covered in a bit of blue plastic. I don't know whether you can see that. But that's quite a good idea, and it's going to make adjusting what is really quite a heavy mount, I think, fairly successful. Another great feature of the mount, it actually got a patented dual encoder system, which enables the mount really to know where it is at all times. So even if the mount is released, and you can see we've got a very small release lock just there, and we've got another one around the front here. Just taking that off. Very light action on these locks as well, by the way. Considering the payload weight of this telescope, actually locking the axes is really quite simple. It's just a tip of your finger job to actually lock it up. Quite like that feature. The dual encoder system, which the manufacturer is claiming it's a totally patented arrangement, enables the telescope to remember where it is. As I say, even when the locks are disengaged, if you move the telescope either electronically or manually, it can still recover its position immediately and carry on where it left off. Another useful feature is it always knows its start position as well, so that the telescope can be immediately sent back to the start position. The motor system employs, I think you can probably see here from the general size of this, if I put my hand up, very large gears. Now the large gears are going to give this a low, smooth periodic error performance anyway, but the telescope mount is actually going to be equipped with permanent programmable periodic error correction. Now, periodic error correction is really a great way of reducing the tracking errors of the mounting. And incidentally, the drive is coupled directly to the worm. So there is no other gear train in this system. The drive motors here go directly onto the worm, and the worm is in tangential contact with the gear here. So there's no periodic error coming in from any kind of drive mediation between the motor and the worm. So that's a good feature anyway. But the programmable periodic error correction basically means that as the worm expresses itself, the user will do a correction sequence using a high power eyepiece with a reticule. As the errors accumulate, you'll watch the star and move the telescope east or west, correcting for the drive errors. And basically, for however long the worm expresses itself, and I haven't had a chance to actually test and time that, but for example, an LX200, the worm cycle lasts around about 11 minutes, typically, so that you track for 11 minutes, and then at the end of that period, the tracking corrections you've made are then played back by the periodic error correction system, and that can usually do a great job, even going as far as halving the periodic error on the mounting. So that's a great feature of what is obviously going to be a very powerful mounting. All pretty familiar here from the EQ6. If I just disconnect the power supply there, simple on and off switch. We've got an autoguider point and the hand controller. The cable connections are fairly straightforward, very tough, all metal connections there. All pretty straightforward, and I say very familiar from the EQ6. Other features include a polarscope system. We've got a very satisfyingly chunky cap on the bottom there, nearly dropped it on the floor. And you can see we've got a polarscope there that's fairly familiar from the EQ5 and the EQ6 models with a built-in reticule. The window for it is uncapped at the front here. Just get a little look at that. And you can see, very simple and straightforward, giving access, giving the polarscope a view of the sky there. Nice little touch here is the scale, promising a certain precision with its tiny little indicator there, actually showing you the latitude as you position it. A little refinement that they seem to have spent more effort on it than you would have perhaps given it credit for. Very beefy counterbalance shaft and weight system. Really quite substantial. That's over a 31 millimeter shaft, so that's about an inch and a quarter in old money. Really quite substantial. That's not going anywhere soon, I don't think. Just take you down as well to look at the tripod down here. They've also, this is a unique tripod. It's got a carbon steel base here. I think we've actually seen something like this on the very largest Celestron mountings. It's obviously been adapted somewhat from this. Now, obviously, we don't really know if the production model is actually going to have anything like this. So, need to take this with a few grains of salt, everything we're showing you here. We've got no absolute certainty that anything really looking exactly like this is going to be on the production model. And last of all, right on the roof, we've got the telescope connection apparatus. This does look very much like a work in progress. It's not a mounting type that we've seen from Skywatcher before. Generally from the gait of what they intend to put on here, it's not unreasonable to assume, I think, that maybe a production model will have one of the large format dovetail bars, possibly like the dovetail bar that they've already used on the NEQ6. At the moment, it's been fitted with a very simple mounting ring plate. We've got position for rocker screws in the middle there. So this is just to take a plain set of rings, but we're kind of assuming that the production model might end up with some kind of larger dovetail bar of some kind. Well, I think that about wraps it up for this video tour of the Skywatcher EQ7, EQ8. Probably as well to warn you to possibly treat everything we've told you there with a bit of skepticism. Taking everything with a few grains of salt wouldn't do you any harm, simply because we can't be sure about the exact nature of the production version of this telescope. Everything we've told you there has really been based on what we've got here in our showroom, the actual metalwork. It is the only one available in the world, and you're welcome to come and have a look at it yourself. It's on permanent display in our showroom. It's available to you all the time that our showroom is open for business. We look forward to possibly seeing you in our showroom so you can take a look at the EQ7 yourself. Anyway, that's it. Bye for now.